I dub thee a nerdy knight of the round, sworn defenders of all who oppress the nerd. Now, on to the round table. Listen to what they say, for their words will guide you.
It's another Nerdy Night as my roundtable joins me on the set late night with Ben, the Ridiculous Riddick. I'll be your host on this year-end recap show. And joining me, as always, is our one-man house band and master of the air guitar, Sam Chen. Thank you, Sam.
That's how the air guitar sounds like for me.
Okay. And our special guest tonight, who's joining us remotely on the set of his new film that he is irrationally passionate about, Alex O'Neill.
Hello.
You guys may remember Alex O'Neill as Other Ben from our Lonely Hearts podcast way back
in
the day.
We've got a lot of Other Bens.
Yeah, we've got Other Ben Brandt. We've got Other Ben Alex.
No. Brandt is the white Ben Riddick.
Oh. Wait, so I'm...
Wait.
We're not saying you're not white. Okay. We're just saying Brandt is the white Ben Riddick.
Okay.
Also like my soulmate.
Yeah.
It's worth noting. So I guess you are as well, Ben.
Yeah.
Oh.
Okay. Making declarations.
So guys, we have a great show planned tonight because we are talking about the best of 2015. But before we get into that, we're going to start with our active quests, like we always do. For those new to the show, active quests is where we talk about the nerdy things we've been doing over the last week. And as always, I like to start with my guest, Alex. Tell me about your day. Your week.
My life. Well,
since last time we had you on the show.
Yeah.
Since Valentine's Day 2014, a lot has happened. Just by the way, a lot has happened. I decided to drink less than I did then, which was a lot. No, I drank significantly more. Let's be honest. I don't know. A lot of stuff has happened in my life since then, but in the past, like, I don't know, month or so, I've been very busy with video games. People might know that I am irrationally passionate as the guy that what made irrationalpassions.com, and we are like doing all of our game of the year stuff. Like, we're getting ready for it. We're preparing, like, writing up the doc for our game of the year show, which is recording in January. And I have been on the prowl recording as many guest top 10 games of 2015 podcasts as I can fit under my belt.
Yeah, which is awesome. I think you and I are doing something.
Yeah, you'll have one.
That's cool.
I usually put the call out sometime in late November, early December. I put it out a little bit earlier this year.
And I somehow missed it.
You missed it, but it's fine because we talked at PSX. And that was like right at the end where I'm like, I need to close
it. More than talk,
because there are too many people. Oh, yeah. We hung out as well. We shared Chipotle not once, but twice. 2 days in a row.
Yeah, there's a lot of number two jokes going on today.
Well... I mean, they didn't hear the first one.
This is true. They did not hear the first number two joke.
Just like you never hear.
It has something to do with Chipotle.
It's what happens after.
I had Chipotle for dinner today. So it all comes back together, full circle.
Well, that's great. I'm glad you're here with us today, Alex. Sam, what has your active quest been?
So I've been quite Jewish over the holiday weekend. That was my active quest, being Jewish. I went and saw the movie The Big Short, which I think everyone should go see. It's basically, imagine the most entertaining version of the mortgage crisis that you could see on the big screen, and it's like twice as funny as that. So it's great. And it has Selena Gomez telling you how like synthetic CDOs work. At the beginning, they talk about like mortgage-backed securities. And they're like, this is going to be really boring if we just explain it to you. So here's this hot model in a tub. And then she's like explaining it while drinking champagne and being naked. It's very amusing.
That sounds absolutely horrible.
Ryan Gosling's in it.
Oh, yay, Ryan Gosling.
Well, love now Ryan I Gosling. Have
that worked out the girls I told. figured with you. Okay. Well, since we're done with that, Ben, what have you been up to?
Sam, you're going to make fun of me. Alex, you're going to make fun of me. I started playing Destiny on Xbox One.
You're kidding me.
Nope.
God.
Oh, Jesus. My God. Oh, like, where did you get a copy of it? You bought it.
Yep.
You spent money on it.
Yep.
See, like, this is where if you weren't married, there'd be a joke about, like, what girl are you going to play it with on Xbox One? But you are married, so that joke doesn't apply. Why are you playing this on Xbox One?
Because I have friends there that are playing it. Oh, no. And I do really like Sherpa-ing raids, and being able to do it everywhere would just be kind of nice.
Oh, my God. So, like, I guess...
It's been a great show tonight.
I can't be too angry at you because my two friends, Tyrone and Joe, have it on Xbox One. And, like, they really want me to get it on Xbox One as well.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I might break.
Yeah. Right? I'm the same way.
I mean, it is relatively cheap now. So,
yeah.
It's not like you're shelling out like $100. I get that.
Mm-hmm. That was my only reasoning for it.
The chat is shaking its head at you.
I know.
It's many heads.
I know. But you know what? You know what else I've been doing? It was Christmas, and Lee pretty much themed all of my Christmas gifts as Star Wars.
Oh, okay. Awesome.
So I did get a Sphero BB-8, which is really
fun. How did the dogs like it?
I don't play with it around the dogs, but I do chase the cat around with it.
Nice.
Which is entertaining as hell.
Does that work well on wood?
Yes, it does.
Okay, cool.
What it does not do, what is kind of a bummer about it is if you have dogs with long hair on wood and it happens to roll over hair, you all of a sudden get BB-8 back and he's got a bunch of hair stuck under his head.
Yeah, I can see that.
So, yeah.
Ben, did you pay for the level
25? No, I did not. I did not. And I would not. And you know what? It's $30.
Yeah, I agree. I second that. It is $30, not
$40. Maybe it's $40 for all characters. No, is it $30 for all characters?
It's $30 for each character.
Yeah. Oh, see?
Oh, but you know who did? Agent Hardwire in the chat did.
Oh, slacker.
Anyways, let's go ahead and get into our first best of 2015. And I thought the best thing to start with would be TV shows.
Okay.
Because TV shows are fun. I like TV. Yes. Sam likes TV. Alex has a TV.
For sure.
Does he? At least he have a TV? Or does he just have a big screen? Like...
I mean, I'm looking at a big screen, and now I'm questioning whether it's a TV or just a screen.
So, just so everyone knows, the way we're going to do this tonight is we are going to, essentially, each of us are going to talk about our third favorite, our second favorite, and our first favorite. And then we are going to try to make a top three list out of our nine. And then before we switch to the next topic, we're going to talk about the biggest busts of the year.
Yes. Or less than nine if we repeat.
Yeah, I guess. I guess that's true.
All right.
Because we definitely did repeat.
So something I would like to do is I would like to start with our guest. Alex, tell me about what you think was the third best television show of 2015.
Okay. Caveat. Right from the start.
Not have your list.
No, I have it. I'm looking at it.
Chicken wing fingers.
Yeah. So my number three I put down was Quantico, which I don't know if either of you have watched Quantico.
I've watched Quantico. I watch Quantico.
So here's the thing. I don't watch a lot of TV, but I know that Sam does. So I know that whatever either of us talk about, Sam will be able to talk about.
Okay, that's good. Quantico is probably not a good TV show, but I love Quantico.
I mean, I like it because, and I might have said it before in the show, is that I expected it to be a very benign crime procedural, and it's not. So yeah. That made me pretty happy.
Yeah, that's fair. There's a lot of good intrigue to it. It is the reason that it kind of sticks out to me is because it is like, I love teenage angst. It's all going out on the table. So like teen drama is like my jam, and this is like teen drama, but like with really moody adults
with guns,
with guns, and they're all like supposed to be FBI agents. So like half of the show is like FBI school, and they're all like being like, Stacy sucks, and then like, but then like people die, and then the rest is like a flash forward. And like there was like a horrible terrorist attack and they're trying to figure out who it was, and that's pretty like cut and dry. But like the school stuff, like cop school, is pretty great.
I will say the other big call out for it, which I think has worked out pretty well for it, is that it stars an Indian American, or I don't know if she's even Indian American, but she's Indian.
She's Indian, yeah.
She's Indian, and she's like a Bollywood star. And so it's pretty cool to have someone like that at the head of a show, even though it's very character driven by a wealth of characters.
Yeah, there's a good diversity on the show, like, and a lot of cultures that are represented in a way that I guess I don't know if they're well represented, but they're at least they're being represented. Yeah. And like like you said, the protagonist is not like a white dude FBI guy. Although that character is for sure on the show.
Very true. Very true.
Okay. All right. Sam, how about you? What is number three?
Number three for me is a show that probably earlier this year or last year, whenever it was announced, that I said was going to suck like completely.
I'm actually really ashamed I haven't watched this one.
Oh, you haven't watched it yet. What's wrong with you? No. So it's Heroes Reborn.
Which I haven't watched it yet either, and I really want to. So
yeah. We got the first 9 of the 12 episodes that were slated to be right now, and then I think in January we were getting the other 3. It is really good. It brings me kind of back to Hero Season 1, which obviously
was fantastic.
That's the best endorsement anyone could give this show.
Yeah, yeah. It's not as convoluted. I think it tries to play up the abilities in a very different way. Mm-hmm. And I think some of that is literally the fact that like CG is better now, or maybe easier for them to do. So they have a little bit more fun with some of the abilities. They give you there's a good balance of nostalgia versus not nostalgia, which I think probably was the key to it taking off at all. Was if it was just a nostalgia show, people wouldn't watch it. So I think they did a good job. They've explained some stuff. I am very happy with it.
That's very good. Happy. That's good.
Ben, how about you?
So my number three is – the funny thing is all three of my shows that I picked are not network television shows.
Of course.
So my number three is actually an Amazon original based off of one of my favorite books – which is The Man in the High Castle.
Your favorite because the Nazis won, man.
That's exactly
Whoa.
Right.
Declarations.
but I think the fact that all three of my shows are not network shows is just a really good compliment to how amazing Netflix and Amazon are doing with their exclusive content. And the production value overall in The Man in the High Castle is just phenomenal. They've got some really awesome actors in it. And, I mean, the show itself is just great. And, I mean, the storyline of it is the Nazis won World War II instead of, you know, the good guys. And now, essentially, the U.S. is split in half. There's the Nazi-controlled eastern portion of the United States, and then there's the Japanese-controlled western portion of the United States, and it's really, really, really an interesting story. And I started reading the book because I was playing Wolfenstein and I wanted to read a book that was Wolfenstein-like. And this book is what kind of fell in my lap. And then when they announced that The Man in the High Castle is going to be an Amazon original, I nearly lost it and had to watch it.
Yeah.
I started rewatching it this morning.
Yeah, I was kind of surprised. So I picked it up today. Kind of surprised I hadn't heard about it until now, considering how much TV I watch. But I think Amazon has it. It's right now, it's the number one viewed streamed show on Amazon.
I'm surprised, like, you haven't seen it.
I know.
Up until now also, because you go to Amazon.
Yeah.
9 times out of 10, the banner on Amazon is The Man in the High Castle. On Twitch, you go to the homepage, and half the time, The Man in the High Castle is the banner image.
To be fair, it has only been out for, what, like 2 months? Month and a half?
Yeah, I guess.
But still, yeah. Like, for how acclaimed it is already, I'm very surprised I haven't heard about it. And I'm very happy 2.5 episodes in to continue watching. So
it is,
and it got picked up for a second season.
Yes, it did. Which is so exciting.
To be fair, none of the other shows that we've listed have been picked up for a second season yet. Although Quantico.
No, I
think Quantico has.
My number one has.
No, we've talked about so far.
Okay. Oh, okay. just kidding. Just kidding.
They don't know what those other shows are, Ben.
Spoiler alert. I love that the chat is still talking about the level boost.
They really are on this lazy Destiny thing.
So let's move on to our number twos.
Okay.
Alex?
My number two is weird because I've only watched 2 episodes of it, of the, I think, 12 that are available now. But that's just how impressive it was. It's one thing, like, I mean to keep going back to, which is an anime. Are you familiar with this? It is One Punch Man.
I am not familiar with it because I'm all about dubbed, not subbed anime.
Yeah, me too. I'm gonna be honest with you, Ben. This is why I think we are kindred spirits. I'm with you.
Okay.
Which, you know, some people have problems with, understandably. But One Punch Man is exactly what it sounds like, which is weird. Like, but it is also so much more. Like, the concept is a man who, like, was just a normal Japanese business dude who got fired, and he gets super pissed and super downtrodden. But I guess, like, he beat, like, a villain, right? It's a world of heroes and villains. And he's like, man, maybe I can do this. Maybe I can be a hero. So he trains for just 3 years, and then he comes back as literally the strongest, fastest, best, most powerful human in all of existence, which is like a play on the idea that, you know, you have to train super hard or whatever to be a hero. And so he can destroy or defeat anyone or anything with just one single punch.
Jesus.
And by, like, destroy, I mean, like, he fights, like, some monsters and he just punches and they just explode. Like, that first episode is graphic and hilarious. Like, the secret magic of the show is it's not really about, like, oh, a guy who can be anything with one punch. It's like a really, really intelligent satire on all of superheroes in general. Like, a lot of big themes across the first couple of episodes are, like, villains coming up to One Punch Man, and he's just, they're like, let me tell you my story. I was once a happy-go-lucky guy, and then this bad thing happened to me, and then I was filled with rage and revenge, and they, like, keep talking. He's like, I really don't care, and he just punches them, and they explode.
Nice!
And it's, like, it's so, like, all the villains have, like, these way long drawn out backstories that like he just does not give a shit about, and it's like playing off of that as well. And like there are all these heroes that are like, I trained for 20 years to become a hero. And he's like, oh, I trained for like 3 years, I guess, and I dieted, and now I'm the strongest thing that's ever lived. And like there's some other characters that work with him that aren't, you know, overly powerful. So like seeing them struggle is, you get some of that like, oh, I want them to be victorious. I want them to find what they're looking for type deal. But like the center theme of just like deconstructing all superhero mythology and whatever is incredible. So it's highly recommended. It's awesome.
Yeah, it's 12 episodes and there's a 6-episode OVA. Are they separate?
I don't know what
I think so.
Think of it like a miniseries, man.
Yeah.
Oh, okay, okay.
Yeah, OVAs are like the miniseries of the anime world.
Gotcha. Yeah, they're just independent.
Okay. What does it stand for?
Original Video Animation.
Okay.
Yep. Super straightforward. Unlike all other anime.
These took you down with a punch, Ben.
I just wanted to know. Citizen PM in the chat, Alex, he's calling us both heathens. And then Nightbot, my shiny knight in shiny armor, came in and just decided to ban him. I don't know why, because Nightbot is crazy.
Nightbot don't give a shit.
No, Nightbot don't give a shit.
Well, Nightbot doesn't like subs for some reason.
Weird.
Nightbot is a Nazi.
I think Nightbot might be racist.
Yeah, probably. He's probably racist. Sam, what is your number two?
My number two, drawing on the world of the Netflix show, is Master of None, starring Aziz Ansari, and probably written by Aziz Ansari as well. Also 10 episodes, kind of this like interesting, like not quite rom-com until the end, but not quite sitcom kind of show, it's basically he's an actor in LA, probably very similar to his life, and he has a group of friends, they hang out, they go party, they sleep with people. It's very normal. I mean, the beginning kind of sets it up as like he's trying to figure out like what to do with his life, and then shit happens. But it's just written really well. It's kind of like, I don't know, like it feels like it could be a network show, but it's not. So it's a little bit more raunchy than that. But
I'm just not a big fan of Aziz Ansari.
So I'm not either. And to be honest, like I have not seen Parks and Rec, which I think is what he's best known for.
Let me just say this. If I were like your friend that doesn't watch shows because of one character, Aziz Ansari's character would be that character in Parks and Rec for me.
I think the biggest thing that like I was afraid of with the show is so like I watch Girls, and I sometimes get the sense that like this is just Lena Dunham like playing her like life fantasy out through a TV show. I was afraid Aziz Ansari was doing that with Master of None, but I don't think he is, which makes the show like 100 times more enjoyable for me. But 10 episodes, watch one.
Okay, I will watch one. I'm going to pick one random one in the middle of it.
Please don't.
I'll say that Aziz Ansari did make a bad first impression on me, but he grew on me with time. So,
okay.
Food for thought. I've only really seen him in ancillary things. Like, he did he had a cameo on one of the like the chef shows on Netflix, and like he seemed like a reasonably like okay guy.
Reasonably okay, Aziz Ansari.
There, hey, if you're an actor, reasonably okay is pretty good.
All right, I'm going to talk about my number two. My number two. I had a battle with what my number two and number one would be, but what finally won out as number two was Jessica Jones, another a Netflix original, Marvel comic, based in the Marvel universe, essentially like just absolutely amazing. And again, just the quality of the acting and the writing in the show were just phenomenal. I mean, they portrayed a girl who had suffered essentially abuse, or you know, just that kind of life, like a they portrayed a PTSD person in a very, what I feel was a very true kind of light. Obviously, I don't have PTSD, so maybe I don't really know how true it is, but it was very grounded and realistic, which I absolutely loved about it. And one of the things that I thought was fantastic was the fact that it's this hero that doesn't necessarily want to be a hero. It's just, it's kind of forced on her.
It's also like in her nature.
Yeah.
In a way that she doesn't really like.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Well, and I'll say this to your point about like realism and capturing whatever. One of my like pseudo things against it by the end of the show was I realized so little the show focuses on the fact that she has powers of some sort that, you know, like I was like that it was almost unnecessary. You could have almost written that entire side out and she could still be the character she was, which to the same credit is a good way of storytelling, right? Because it's being about her and not about the fact that she can lift heavy things and jump high or anything like that. So,
like you were saying, I think that's what I liked about it a lot, is it didn't focus on that so much. And the villain, holy shit, dude, his name escapes me. Oh my god,
Kilgrave.
No, not Kilgrave. The actor's name.
David Tennant.
David Tennant. Yeah.
Thank you, everyone. I really appreciate the backup on that.
here for you, man.
He was phenomenal in that role. Like there were times that I legitimately felt bad for him, even though I knew that I shouldn't. And
now you're gonna watch Doctor Who?
I mean, I do really want to watch Doctor Who. It's more of a time thing. There's a lot of Doctor Who to watch.
Yes.
Seasons?
Ever? Are you guys ready to talk about our number ones? I mean, that's really what people came here for. Alex and Sam, I'm going to have you guys talk about your number one together.
I'll say real quick. I chose some different stuff because I wanted to put some different stuff out there. Except like I saw that Sam had my number one as well, and I thought that we could have a good conversation about it. Jessica Jones is my real number one. I'll say like that's my favorite, probably my favorite TV show I've ever watched, because it is exactly to my taste. Which is to say, it's noir, it's like a detective mystery, and I just really connected with Jessica Jones as a character, plus it has superpowers. So yeah, that's up there for me. I chose some different stuff.
It was like Veronica Mars with superpowers.
I've never watched Veronica Mars.
Oh my god, Alex, you gotta go watch Veronica Mars.
One of the biggest holes in my like TV viewing history is Veronica Mars. I understand that. But yeah, Jessica Jones is the best thing Marvel has ever done, in my opinion.
Oh, so, wow. Heavy praise.
Yeah, like that show really, really connected to me in a way that I'm sure it did not connect to most other people. Yeah, that's hands down. I feel very strongly about it.
Agent Hardwire in the chat says you need to watch Veronica Mars.
Yeah, I do. But I also feel very strongly about Mr. Robot.
Okay.
Yeah.
Tell me more.
Shout out from the chat for Unbreakable Kimmy Schmidt, which is also really good.
Mm-hmm. Sam, yes. What did you think, Mr. Robot?
I thought it was I thought it was really well done. It's I picked it up not because I had actually heard about it or anything like that, but there was an article out on one of my photography blogs that was talking about how like they made a very, very like distinct style choice to like crop people weird and to like do really like abnormal camera angles where like, you know, normally if you were like sitting in a grid and in a standard widescreen, you'd have someone facing one side and then the character would be on that juxtaposed onto the other side now. So basically, it was saying it was like really breaking up the visual for you. And they were talking about how that kind of, you know, played into the show. So that got me started on the show. Then when I started watching it, I thought it was like amazing. It was really, really good. So basically, it's a like, without giving too much away, it's like a Fight Club-esque future of like us hacking things, and like the major plot line through the show is that they want to try to like down the government essentially, or take down the world's corporations by doing this like one big thing. I don't know if we how much to spoil about the show.
Yeah, I want to try to keep it as spoiler free as possible, so that
big thing stuff.
Yeah,
he's basically a hacker. He's a hacker who has like depression problems.
Yeah.
The first episode you see.
Apparently, one of the kids from Until Dawn, isn't it? The video game.
Yeah, he plays the main character. It's Rami Malek who plays the main character of this show. So.
Gotcha.
It
looks like a prototypical like weird hacker type. It's great.
Yeah. The first scene of the first episode is probably enough to sell just about anyone on the show. I think like it's just him, like this weird. It starts with his internal monologue, but then it's like this very weirdly direct conversation he has with, like this person he's never met before, but feels like he knows everything about because he's quote unquote hacked him, in like a little cafe, and it's like. You know, like Sam was saying, like the directing, how it's shot, how it's lined up, everything is like crazy and different. And it was immediately something like I've never seen before. And it's that first like 60-minute pilot is like, that'll sell you hands down. It's an easy sell. It's really great. But yeah, it also is like one of the best portrayals of like actual hacking. This is no like flying into a computer screen and like digital lines of binary code flying across the screen. Is that?
It definitely sounds cool. It sounds like a show that's right up my alley. I just, again, haven't sat down to watch it. I feel like we are having some audio and video issues right now. It's another Nerdy Night as my roundtable joins me late night.
We're not restarting.
Ridiculous, Riddick. And we have a great show planned for you. We left off with Sam. God damn. Oh, wait, is it doing it again, or are you just saying?
No. We were just making fun of you.
Okay. Whew. We left off. You're
talking to Mike.
Yeah, I am. Sorry. Because why not be incredibly confusing if I can? We left off with me about to talk about my number one show, because both Sam and kind of Alex's number one was Mr. Robot.
Yeah.
Whereas my number one show was Daredevil, which was Netflix's first step into the Marvel Cinematic Universe. And I thought they did a fantastic job of making a hero that I otherwise didn't care that much about into a character that I cared more about.
I thought it was definitely a step in the right direction, given that there were maybe, I don't know if it was one or two movies about Daredevil prior, right? At least one.
One. It was just one.
There was one.
Yeah.
Which I did not think was as good as the show, but...
That is not an unpopular opinion.
It's because it was not as good as the show, yeah. no, and honestly, one of the things that this show... The reason why it made it to my number one is a single 7-minute scene that made it my number one show. Because this is something that I do... where I will watch a show and I will count in my head the seconds of a single camera shot. So, you know, without it switching to a different camera. And I watched that one fight scene, I think it's in like episode 3, where the camera...
It's episode 2.
Episode 2. Mm-hmm. The camera does not move, or rather the camera does not switch or change. It's not cut. Thank you, Mike. I really appreciate your help here. There's no cuts in it at all for 7 straight minutes. And it's a fight scene. And it's fantastic. Mm-hmm. I might be exaggerating on 7 minutes. I feel like that's a really long time.
Apparently you're not counting seconds in your head.
It was 4.5 is what Mike is telling me. It's an incredibly long scene nonetheless, especially with how much was going on. And I immediately, as soon as I saw that episode, I went online and I researched it, and you know, they went over how it was done, and it's just like, oh my god, this is so amazing. It's like during that scene there were pretty much 3 different daredevils going in and out of the doors to make that scene work.
Mm-hmm.
I was so into that show. Mm. And the end of the... Never mind. I can't... I don't want to spoil it. Right. It's a great show.
We did just tell everyone this.
And another one where I thought the acting was phenomenal. Another villain that was very, very creepy. Yeah, just a creepy villain, but I liked it.
Yeah.
So that was my number one. So of all of these shows, I think it's pretty safe to say that Mr. Robot is pretty much getting a top spot in our top 3.
Yeah, I would say.
Okay. I think Jessica Jones should definitely be in our top 3.
Yep. I'm okay with that.
Okay. And our third one, I would kind of be okay with Daredevil being in it also. But
so lame. So lame. No, I'm just kidding.
What if
Daredevil could be,
you think, was better than Daredevil?
I can't hear anything.
I can. What if Daredevil? Sam, are you with me?
I'm with you.
What if Daredevil could beat everything with one punch? One Punch Man.
Yeah, I'm okay with Daredevil being there. I mean, let's face it, we've all watched it.
Yeah, it's great.
Yep.
How far into the episode is this scene?
It's at the very end.
It's at the very end.
Okay.
I know what you're talking about now.
Yeah. It's the hallway scene.
I wasn't doing the math on which scene it was. So.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But no, it was. It's a great scene. And so our top 3, do you want to say Jessica Jones, Mr. Robot, Daredevil?
I mean, I'm okay with saying that. I firmly do not believe Jessica Jones was as good as either of you are making it out to be. I think it was very good, but like, I can't discuss my frustrations without spoiling the plot.
Mm.
So let's just say that my biggest frustration was with the plot, okay, and how episode 6 through 9 play out in the show.
Okay.
Because I feel like to enhance the character building of the show, the plot takes a turn that, in my mind, it should not have taken.
Okay. I know exactly what you're talking about.
Doesn't not take a turn that it should have.
Yeah.
I know what you're talking about, yeah.
But that's fine. I'm okay with putting it on the pedestal because it was good.
Do you think Daredevil was better?
Do I think Daredevil was better? Personally,
I mean, I personally think it was better, but...
I think it was better... But in contrast to Jessica Jones, my biggest fault with Daredevil was with the villain. And I think we've talked about this, and Chris and I have talked about this, where because I don't really understand the entire backstory of it, I may not have a greater appreciation of the villain.
No, and that's perfectly understandable. I mean, the show should have... Not everyone that's watching the show is going to have the background on the character. So if your issue is not having enough background with the character, then that's a problem with the show, not with your knowledge.
Yeah, I mean, to the point, like, David Kilgrave was fucking scary, right? Like, you figure out what he could do, and you're like, fuck, I don't want to mess with that guy. Not so much in Daredevil. Like, he's kind of crazy. Wilson Fisk
is more like off-putting than he is actually intimidating.
He really should be off-putting.
And the thing is, like, people cite that one scene where he, like, does something to a guy's head. And I'm like, that wasn't that bad. Like, I mean, in the grand scheme of things, like, that's not evil. Like, I mean, it's violent, but...
Yeah, but
I want my villains to be evil.
I guess the point is that wouldn't happen on regular television, but I agree.
I mean, I think, like, the Fisk stuff is, like, you know, Kilgrave is truly, like, he is evil to the core in a way that is, like, incomprehensible, but Fisk is, like, misguided and sympathetic in a way
that makes
him complex.
On that point, I think it's one of those things, it's like, Kilgrave knows he's evil.
I think past that, I think Kilgrave specifically doesn't believe that he's evil.
I think he should.
Well, but he's what?
I think he's just a sociopath.
Yeah. Okay.
I think he's so disassociated himself from morality. He doesn't take responsibility for anything that he actually does. That he doesn't. It is impossible for him to see himself as evil, and that is like pure evil.
But he also doesn't see himself as good.
Yeah.
No. Right. But I see it this way. If he used his power to like the full extent of what he knows it to be, like. There would be no battle, right? Like, there's nothing in this that makes you – the only limiting factor is a very, like, specific personal thing for you.
Yeah, right? I think – I feel like we could have an entire episode on just talking about the villains of Netflix original Marvel shows.
Which we should.
So I think on that –
That's some other
Let's agree we'll do Jessica Jones, Mr. Robot, Daredevil, the Nerdy Knights of the Round top Fine. Three
Done.
TV shows, and let's move on to movies. I was honestly shocked that all three of us did not pick the same number one, and I was kind of disappointed, but...
Our guest.
But it's okay, because we still love you, Alex.
There's a ton of us in our list, which is great.
There is a ton of overlaps list. Alex, what is your third favorite movie of 2015?
If you had asked me like that, this would fall like at the bottom of this short list. But when 2015 began, I would have called you a crazy person. But honestly, like this was the one that I thought was a shoo-in for number one, which is Avengers 2, Age of Ultron. And the other two I didn't expect to like. Especially my number two, which I was very skeptical about going in, but we can get to that in a little bit.
I will say I was very surprised to see this on your list at all.
Yeah, I was really happy walking out of Avengers 2, and I'm still like really happy with it. It has a lot of issues that I think definitely have sunk in more as time's gone on. But, like, it is also still, like, really, really charming in a way that, like, nothing will ever, like, be able to replicate that first time I saw Avengers 1. It can never be – the sequel could never be as good as that. And I didn't necessarily want it to be. I wanted it to be something different. It was. It had a lot of cool new characters. Go ahead.
I don't know if he's lagged out.
I didn't say anything.
Okay.
Your video cut.
Somewhere Mike is like, okay. like tossing shit together.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
I can hear you. We can.
Okay. Well, that's the important part.
Mm-hmm.
So for me, I think as far as Avengers goes, like I agree. I was really happy coming out of it. I really liked the new characters they introduced. I thought they did an awesome job with Ultron. I thought Paul Bettany did an awesome job in the movie. Mm-hmm. And I was very happy coming out of the movie. But there were so many other movies that came out this year that I enjoyed the same, if not more.
And like that also brings up another point. Like, this wasn't a good year for movies for me, unfortunately. I didn't get out to see as much stuff as I wanted to. Like, I haven't
so much more stuff this year than I did last year.
Yeah, last year was crazy for me. But like, I maybe only saw like 6 movies this year, probably less. Yeah.
So I'll say this before we move on to the next.
I think I've seen my number one almost 6 times.
I haven't even seen it twice, but I will. To me, I actually felt almost the exact opposite coming out of the movie. Like, it was interesting, but I feel like if the rest of the Marvel Cinematic Universe movies are formulated around the same context as this, like, it will not succeed in the long run. Like, I felt like the way they played on the characters and how they interacted and how that played into the story arc was just so weak. It was literally like, hey, let's bring out these great characters that people love and maybe some that people haven't heard of, and that's our movie, folks. That's what it felt like to me.
I think that's fair. Like, you know, like I said, it's not without issues. I really liked it just because, like, I feel like they didn't have to, like, establish the relationship between everyone anymore, right? Like, it had already been established in the first one. So, like, you know, Thor and Hulk have this thing. Iron Man and Captain America have this thing. Like, they have, like, a repertoire. They go back and forth. And they play into that. Like, there's a lot of funny moments in this movie that, like, really stick out in my mind. It's, like, it's a really, really funny movie.
But I do kind of agree with Sam also. The first Avengers, every movie had something that built into it.
Yeah.
More solidly. And this one really didn't. And I guess, like, I don't know. I think Captain America Civil War is going to be more Avengers 2 than Avengers 2 was Avengers 2.
I don't disagree with you. Although I have a very different expectation for Captain America Civil War, having like the knowledge of what the comic is and not expecting it to be anything like that. because like, I feel like if you do expect that, you're going to be really disappointed. But yeah, like I think like having conflict between them is like where they should have gone. And I think that's where they're going. Captain America 2 is probably the best Marvel movie. And I think the Russo brothers are doing a lot of really crazy stuff. So I think where they're going to go next with Civil War is going to be awesome.
Yeah. I mean, I almost liked the fact that Ant-Man came out this year. It was kind of almost like, even though it is Marvel, it was kind of like slapping Marvel around a little bit, which is really amusing to me.
Yeah. They really had fun with that one. So,
yeah. All right.
Let's move on to your number 3, Sam.
Well, okay, my number 3 is Alex's number 1. Should we just talk about it simultaneously?
Spoiler alert.
I have a story that I can tell when I talk about it, so you can go ahead, Sam.
Okay. So my number 3 was Inside Out, which was really good. It starred a cast of veritable voices that most may recognize. But I mean, long story short, it was a Pixar movie where it kind of takes place roughly in like a girl's head. And there's 5 characters that are the different moods that are kind of like driving the character. And I guess like the overarching story plot is that, you know, the girl literally is like leaving her home, I think in Minnesota or Michigan or something like that, and moving out to the Bay Area. And like, she's like 12 or 13, and like all of the like anguish and everything that goes around with it throws her mind into complete disarray. And then, you know, of course, the little 5 actors who represent the moods kind of bring that all together. I mean, to me, I think the biggest standout, and we talked about this a while ago when we talked about cartoons and animated series, is that there was really a direct, like, if you were an adult, you could enjoy this. If you were a kid, you could enjoy this. Even if you didn't understand some of the, like, more overarching tones of the movie, and I thought that's what really stood out to me, is that it was, you know, for all ages, but deep, like deeper than, you know, Good Dinosaurs.
Yeah, you know, I
sick burn.
Oh,
I have to say this one, Inside Out, really, like, it hit really close to home for me.
Hit in the feels,
right? Because growing up, I moved a lot. I changed schools a lot. I was taken away from all of these close friends that I made and thrown into new places all the time. So, you know, it was a great movie. I think Pixar has done better. But, you know, comparing it to other Pixar movies, I feel like it could have been better, is all. But emotionally, it hit me hard. Slapped me with a bag of bricks in the face.
We'll let Alex tell his story when we get to him.
Oh, I'm saving it, yeah.
Oh, he's saving it. He's saving it. Awesome. All right, Ben. Your number three.
My number three was a movie that I also was not sure I would like. Because, you know, this franchise has kind of burned me already with its third iteration of a movie. and that was Jurassic World. I was so incredibly happy to be thrown back into the world of Jurassic Park with this new movie. And it was one of those movies where I walked out of the theater with just a big-ass grin on my face because of how just exciting it was. It might not have been a great movie. Like, I definitely had issues with Bryce Dallas Howard. Well, that was really it. but I enjoyed the movie a lot, and dinosaurs are awesome. And I really liked the way they tied it into the first movie. Like, they even had the Asian scientist from Jurassic Park there creating these new dinosaurs. And they even went in and explained why velociraptors don't look like velociraptors.
they fixed the science.
Yeah, they fixed the science with it. And I thought it was very creative how they did that. And I enjoyed it a lot. I mean, did you guys not enjoy Jurassic World?
I never saw it, so.
It's on my list. It's on my list.
What?
I didn't see The Martian either. Like I said, I'm terrible. I wanted to see like half the movies.
Just leaving.
That came out this year.
Coincidentally, Jurassic World was when like I was traveling on vacation a lot. And then by the time I got back, I just didn't really have a sense of actually watching it. Like, I don't watch a lot of movies, and I'll just tell you, within the last month, I've probably watched more movies than I did in like the last 2 years.
Dude, like, Citizen PM hasn't seen it either. How am I surrounded by people who have not seen this movie?
Did well in the box office.
Yeah, it did well in the box office.
I have no idea how that you guys haven't seen it. The box office, though.
Yeah, I mean, it was one of those things where I just think, I don't know. I knew it was a good movie, and I knew it was doing well in the box office. I coincidentally also never really heard people talking about it.
Yeah, same.
Okay, fine.
And I blame you for that, Ben, because you loved it, so you should have been talking about it all the time.
Yeah. Well.
Not really.
I guess it's just because I have, you know, a significant other to go see movies with and stuff like that.
No, just rub it in, buddy. You're really getting some good graces over here.
Shout out to Citizen for giving me that ammo. Thank you so much.
don't worry. We'll have a Lonely Hearts episode where you're not invited.
Oh, that's fine. Whatever. Do whatever you want, Sam.
Okay.
Alex, what is number two?
For me, number two is Star Wars, which I know a lot of people here seem to feel very strongly about it. So I'm a little hesitant to voice why it wasn't number two.
Do it.
I went into this movie not expecting it to be good. Okay. I had very low expectations. I think that was like...
Okay, real quick. No spoilers for Star Wars are going to be mentioned in this...
No.
In this at all. Okay? Just whether or not we liked the movie is going to be voiced. Yeah. So if you find that a spoiler... Then you might want to not listen.
I saw by myself as well, also to Asian Hardwire, in the chat. So I saw it like I had an extra couple hours after I got off work. They were showing screenings at 1 a.m. that Thursday, and I wasn't working until late the next day. So I was like, oh well, I'm gonna be up for a while, so I'll go see it. Like I want to see it. I want to know whether or not I can like Star Wars again, because I was one of those people real burned by the prequels. Yeah. I think Attack of the Clones is the worst movie I've ever seen in my entire life. It's an atrocious pile of garbage.
So you think Attack of the Clones? Never mind.
Yeah, I think that was the worst one.
Okay.
Full disclosure. That's a discussion we could have for a while. So going into this one, like low expectation, low bar. Totally open to the idea of liking it, and I loved it. Like I loved it. I didn't like taking myself out of it. I loved it because it was like, oh, it's a good Star Wars movie. I think it is a great movie. I don't think it's amazing. I have a lot of issues with the movie, which I won't go into, obviously, for people who like haven't seen it yet. But like, you know, that didn't hold me back from loving it. But it did hold me back from feeling certain things about it. And I'm still, I would say, hesitant as to where they're going to go. I think they have a couple paths that they can go, and I'm hoping it's one more over the other. Mm-hmm. But like, I loved how much they focus on what was new. Especially the characters. Like the focus on the newer people is why that movie is good, I think.
We're approaching very close to spoiler territory. Yeah.
I mean, I'll give you that. If I look at all of this and I think if this was my introduction to the Star Wars universe, how would I feel about it? Yeah, I probably wouldn't feel like it was the best ever.
I think if you hadn't seen any Star Wars movie, this might even. I think this could be better. Just because of like how they do characters and stuff. There is definitely like some stuff that a lot of people probably wouldn't get, but that's, you know, to be expected with a seventh in a series. But yeah, like I said, I loved it, but I have issues with it, that we can't get into. But yeah, what's new makes that movie fresh in a way that I wasn't expecting. And I was really happy with that. So,
mm-hmm.
All right,
Sam, number two.
Surprisingly not on anyone else's list.
You know, I completely forgot about it. And then I saw it on your list. I'm like, ah.
Oh, The Martian. Well,
at least we're going to talk.
I want to see this so bad. So it is killing me.
First of all, I think it's on streaming now. It may be. It's definitely on DVD. It's definitely on DVD and Blu-ray or whatever. It may be on streaming. The Martian, which I like. So first of all, like I really get scared whenever any of my good friends are like, hey, like I really love the story behind this. I love this movie, like the concept. You need to go see this movie, because like if I don't like it, I feel like I'm like disappointing their character. Fortunately, that was not the case. The Martian was great. For anyone who hasn't seen it, doesn't know what it's about, basically. A guy, there's a manned mission to Mars. They're on there for a certain amount of time, and essentially this guy gets stranded as they're trying to escape this like huge dust storm. And it's about his story of being stuck on Mars by himself, because the crew thinks he's dead, and you know he's got to find a way to live for however long until they get him back. So yeah, it was really great. I know like the backstory from the books is that it's scientifically accurate, which obviously doesn't come across in a movie. Like you they could have fudged things and it would have been fine, but you know, it was scientifically realistic.
think
mythologists will have a hard time proving it. He based a lot of the science on it on a book that came out like 30 years ago called A Case for Mars, which is essentially some guy writing about how in the 70s we had the technology to do manned missions to Mars. There's a lot of science behind it that is, it's sound science.
Yeah. Even without the science, it just has a good mix of humor in it that, like, it to me, it feels like a better version of Apollo 13, which, to be fair, like, Apollo 13 was much more grounded in reality and therefore could not be as great in concept, yeah. But it gives you kind of all of the same, like, tugs and pulls of Apollo 13 with, like, a little bit better humor. And so, definitely a must-see. Like, definitely worth watching.
I agree. Absolutely would recommend it to anyone who yeah. Yeah, The Martian. My number two, which I'm not surprised to see on no one's list, because this happens every year. I pick a movie that might not have been everyone's favorite, but I just absolutely had a blast seeing. And this year, that movie is Kingsman.
I really liked The Kingsman.
No, Kingsman was great.
That movie was fantastic. Like, the fight scenes in it, like, one of my favorite things about that movie were the fight scenes and how, like, more recently, fight scenes are always done zoomed in very close to the fight. Whereas in this one, the camera was out of the fight a lot of the time, so you could see how well choreographed some of this stuff was. It was Asian style. You know, it was...
Excuse me, what?
I don't know about that.
That was Mike in my ear, I swear. Well, I mean, it's kind of like... It was very reminiscent of, like, Kill Bill for me.
Yeah.
Like, those kinds of fights.
That's definitely true.
Without spoiling anything, just the church scene.
Yeah.
I just saw a gif of the church scene.
Oh, my God.
Today on social. I don't know if that person had watched the movie, but that church scene is... It's awesome.
The church scene was fantastic and so well done.
Yeah.
And it was just, again, a great, fun movie, and I'm excited about the second one.
There's a second one?
Yeah.
Did not know that.
Yeah, oh, yeah. Another one.
Did not know that.
It's also based off of a comic book, which is an amazing comic book, and I highly recommend to anyone who has not read it.
Same title.
Yeah, Kingsman. I think it's Kingsman, the Queen's Secret Service, or something like that.
What the full title of the film is, probably.
Yeah.
Yeah,
but fantastic movie, and I urge anyone who has not seen it to go see it.
Yeah, it's just going to be a fun movie. Like it's like a Bond movie that doesn't take itself seriously at all.
Yeah,
yeah, I would say it was definitely more self-serious than I expected it would be. Like the main character has like a story where I didn't expect there to be much of one. And there's like a journey and there's trials and tribulations mixed up with some humor. And I didn't expect there to be really any serious part. I expected it to be kind of more like a spoof movie about a spy movie. But it is like, there is a through line that is pretty legitimate as well.
Yeah. If on the continuum of like Spy Kids to 007.
Yeah.
It's closer to 007.
Yeah. Yeah. And
it's a really, really wide gap that you just,
It is. It's a white. I'm looking at opposite ends of the spy spectrum. Okay.
Yeah, and Samuel L. Jackson's an amazing villain in that movie. Oh, yeah. Holy crap!
It really is.
Holy crap!
absolutely phenomenal movie. Let's move on to our number ones.
Let me tell you a story.
All talked about.
tell me about.
Tell us the story. Inside Out.
It's a PlayStation experience. And I'm flying from Maryland to San Francisco. You saw
this during PlayStation Experience?
No. Flying from Maryland to San Francisco.
Okay.
I'm a connecting flight in Chicago and then Chicago to San Francisco. So I'm 5-hour flight. I'm cozied up. I'm like, why don't I, you know, this is a flight. why don't I watch a movie? That's how people pass time.
Yeah, it's true.
And I was like, well, I've heard really good things about Inside Out. I should watch that. How terrible an idea to watch that surrounded by people I don't know. because I have joined the Mile Cry Club. which I don't know if I'm like necessarily proud or like really disappointed in myself, but I cried almost from beginning to end of that movie. There were like intermittent points of like just like dryness when like adventure is happening and stuff. But like just anytime like there was even like a hint of like it's time to get emotional, I'm like I'm covering my face, like the sides of my face, so no one like on the sides of me can see that tears are just streaming down my face. And of course, the very nice lady next to me, who's very considerate, is wearing a blindfold and Bose headphones, like completely cut off from the flight for all the moments except the entirety of when I was watching this movie. So I'm just sitting there in my head like, she thinks I'm weird. I'm sitting here crying watching a movie for kids and she thinks I'm weird. But yeah, I feel like as someone who suffers from, I don't mean to get this super real quick, but as someone who suffers from clinical depression and like having experienced sadness like that you just can't explain, right? Like there is emotions that you get that you can't explain why you're feeling this. Really, like, I don't know, they like hit on that chord so well in this movie and they pulled at my heartstrings so well of like, you know, sometimes there isn't a reason, but like sometimes you need to feel sad so that you can feel happy again. And like sometimes you need to appreciate and feel sad and just let that out. So that you can be happy again and like feel relieved and get that relief. And that was like really the message of the movie. It was like a balance between happiness and sadness because you need both in your life.
Well, I thought they did it in such an approachable way too. Like it wasn't like a therapist telling you that.
No.
And it also wasn't like, let's joke around and like make some story where you're trying to like touch on that. Like, because there's actually emotions as characters in the movies, they can like attack it right on, but also in a way that isn't like too deep for kids.
Yeah,
it's deep for anyone, actually.
It's super subtle. Like,
and they're already talking about how they're using this movie in children's psychology clinics to help kids understand how to explain, you know, their emotions.
Yeah, and it's just like it really connected with me. In my opinion, it's the best movie Pixar has ever made. And it is my favorite Pixar movie, which I didn't expect it to resonate with me as much as it did, especially over something like Toy Story 3, which is for me, like, having like,
Wall-E, I was, man, that one's my favorite.
A lot of people like Wall-E. Like for me, I was the age of the main character of Toy Story when Toy Story 1 came out. And I was the age of the main character when Toy Story 3 came out. So, like seeing those movies as I grew up was like that finale for that
you were movie. Their target.
Yeah, I was their target audience. The 90s kid, it was really a hit home for me. So like seeing like this kind of chapter close in my life with Toy Story 3, and of course they're making a 4 now, but like whatever. like having that, like that feeling, and like that, and like that movie is about like kind of accepting inevitability. Like this movie even overrode that. And again, like there are a lot of messages there that I think resonated with me more than will with a lot of people. And like, that's fine. And I'm glad that you guys like it as well, though. It's a really specific movie to my interests. And like, it was an unforgettable experience, regardless of the fact that I was on an airplane at the time.
Yeah, I mean, I probably watched it around the same time you did, to be honest. And the worst part of it was, like, the next week, my friends were like, let's go see Good Dinosaur. And I'm like, all right, like, I'm in a Pixar mood. That was good. And then it was like, nah, this is not, like, even remotely close to as good.
Yeah, that's what I've heard, which is unfortunate, but, you know.
It's good. It's just not, like, when I'm comparing it to Inside Out, like, it.
Yeah, it doesn't hold a candle, right? So.
Yeah, I mean, so. People who see some movies with me might know this, but I get very emotional in movies. very easily.
Yeah.
And I was kind of surprised that throughout the movie of Inside Out, I did not really get that emotional. It wasn't until like the very end where I just like lost it.
Yeah.
Like for pretty much the last like 20 minutes of the movie, it was just a nonstop stream of tears. But I was in a very dark room and no one else could see me. So
if I had watched that alone at my house, I would have been like wailing, like loudly sobbing as like obnoxiously as possible. Like I can't even imagine. I'm kind of glad I didn't. But it's a great movie. I love it. So
yeah. And yes, Agent Hardwire, I do have emotions, a lot of them. Sam, let's talk about our number one.
Yeah.
Star Wars.
Interestingly enough, I had the same feeling that Alex did on Inside Out when I was watching Star Wars. I
had a lot of the same feeling.
So I watched it in 3D and I was like, all right, I'm watching it in 3D. I'm going to wear my contacts. And I was like, well, shit, maybe if my eyes didn't tear up so fucking much, like this would be okay. But that nostalgia really hit home.
Like, I started crying when the crawl started. Like, yeah. I just teared up. I'm like, oh God. So,
so much. Okay. Obviously it's Star Wars.
Yeah. No, absolutely. And I agree. I mean, I don't think I've ever experienced a movie where I'm sitting in the seat and the Lucasfilm logo pops up and all of a sudden my heart just starts racing. Like I'm literally sitting there like, oh my God, I'm about to have a heart attack.
Yeah. If I was in an opening night.
Making fun of me because I'm getting teary-eyed right now, which you guys can't see because I have my camera off.
I understand though. Like, again, it was a thing of like, when I went into it, I didn't know if I could care about Star Wars anymore. And I care a lot. I realized.
I care a lot too. I care so much. 2 days after I saw the movie, I bought the visual dictionary so I could learn more.
I need to enrich my life.
To get this.
you guys can't see it, and I'll mess Mike up if I show it. I'll show you after the show.
Okay.
It's awesome.
Okay.
That movie though. And I am actually starting to cry. Just
citizens calling you out for breaking your camera on purpose. Just
in anticipation, right?
Yeah. No, I mean, I have such fond memories of Star Wars. Like the first, Alex, I don't know if you know this, but the first time my first Star Wars experience, I saw episodes 4, 5, and 6 in theaters with my dad.
Totally that.
And we were the only ones in the theater.
All
three of them. And it was just like the best moment that I think I've shared with my dad when I was that age. And going in and seeing Star Wars, it made me sad that I was not seeing it with my dad.
Yeah, me too. Like my first experience with Star Wars was watching A New Hope on VHS with my dad in my living room, and then we went out and we watched Empire Strikes Back in movie theaters, and I was like maybe 4, and as a 4-year-old, that shit was the coolest thing I had ever seen in my entire life. Yeah. That is still my favorite movie-going experience ever. So,
and I agree. I think I was like 4 or 5 when we saw this, but I remember it so vividly, down to where we sat in the theater, the fact that I was running up and down the aisle pretending to do lightsaber battles. And, you know, just I just remember it so vividly, and it's like the only memory that I'm able to really retain from that time period of my life.
Yeah.
I'm assuming based on timing, because I'm not totally sure how old you guys were. Do you watch the originals or do you watch special editions?
I watched the originals.
Yeah, mine were the originals.
That's what I figured.
My dad owned a video store at one point, so he had copies of the original.
Yeah, not VHS's. First run originals.
Yeah. So
yeah, because I did not. The only version of the new ones or the originals that I saw in theaters were the new ones.
Yeah, it was. I think it might have been an updated version of Empire, but it was in the 90s, so like I don't think much had changed. So
No, I only saw the special editions, which sucks. But
they're releasing the originals on Blu-ray.
The originals on VHS.
They're going to be releasing the originals on Blu-rays. Yeah.
Okay. This is real, right? Like this is
Okay.
Yeah. Dude, Disney is not going to be like, oh.
What I'm saying is like,
let's
not see that. You see people trolling with that all the time. All like the only thing that could possibly be trolled more than that was Final Fantasy VII Remake.
Yeah, which they trolled and then they're like, no, no, but for real. Yeah. No, I agree.
All right. So, I'm sorry, Alex, but I think Sam and I are going to beat you down to say Star Wars was number one.
That's fine.
Good. Good.
I loved it. So like I just Inside Out resonated in a way that I don't think any other movie would have. And if I hadn't seen Inside Out, Star Wars would be my number one. So,
all right. Well, there you go. A ringing endorsement. If I hadn't seen this movie would have been the best.
Inside Out 2?
Don't say that.
Yeah, I think Inside Out should be number two as well. It was great. Not my favorite, but, you know.
I was saying don't say Inside Out 2 as in don't make a sequel to that.
No, do not make
a sequel. Let me know.
Number three.
I honestly think number three should be The Martian.
I'm okay with that.
Yeah.
So, Nerdy Knights, top three movies of 2015 go Star Wars, The Force Awakens, Inside Out, and The Martian.
I need to see
I'm going to make freaking, like, certificates. I'm going to mail them to these studios. They're going to be like, what the fuck is this?
Yeah.
I will say it would have been very amusing if we had picked, like, Avengers, and then Disney would just have a clean sweep.
Yeah. That's why we picked The Martian.
We did that. Oh, man. Agent Hardwire's parents did not like Star Wars.
Oh.
So she didn't see it until she was 13.
That's
rough. Oh, my God.
That's rough.
Although I imagine, like, as a teenager, Star Wars is pretty good. Like, it's pretty good to see Star Wars as a teenager. I would say better to see as a kid, but, like...
Guys, we've been running a long time.
I know. That's what I do.
We need to talk about video games.
He run long time.
Yeah, I run long time. All right. I make all video podcasts games. I touch longer.
Video games. Top three for every person. Let's start with number three. Go, Alex.
So this is, you guys are probably going to be annoyed with me, but like full disclosure, this list is not final until the Irrational Passions Fat Lady Sings. So until
you with a wig.
Until January 9th, this list is not technically final. So if you are a fan of Irrational Passions as well, do not take this as gospel. My list could change between now and when I record my top 10, which if you don't know what my top 10 is, you should go check out irrationalpassions.com.
Use the command guest in chat.
My number three, I'm going to just really quickly double check this because I do have it written down somewhere. So my number three is Metal Gear Solid 5, The Phantom Pain. Have you heard of this game?
No, so I have not.
I really want to play it. And
I do too.
I haven't mainly because like I do the PlayStation sharing account thing, and the person who I share the account with like has no interest in playing it. So
yeah,
like for me, it's more like I'll just wait till it goes down.
Like Kenny is the person I share my account with. He is so into Metal Gear.
And he doesn't want to play it?
And I'm like, oh, cool, I'll get to play Metal Gear Solid 5. I don't really care, but because Kenny's going to get it, I'll play it. He never got it. And now I'm kind of bummed that he never got it.
Lame.
Because
how
I don't.
How do you guys do your share thing? Why doesn't he just get it?
What?
Do you guys have to like agree on a game for you?
No, 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 no. Not at all.
Okay.
Yeah,
we just buy the games that we want to play. I happen to want to play more games than him. So typically I just buy the games that I want and he buys the games we both want. That's usually how it works out.
I buy most of my games physically, not because I want to, but because Best Buy gives 20% off all new game purchases if you have Gamer Club unlocked. So it's more of a necessity to save money.
This episode of the Nerdy Knights Radio brought to you by Best Buy.
It's the Best Buy in video games.
Why Metal Gear is supposedly an amazing game.
It is.
Masterpiece by some people.
I would even consider... I've written a review that I've not finished, but I would even consider calling it a masterpiece. I wrote this review a while ago when I actually finished it. It was something that I wanted to sit on and come back to. We'll see kind of where that is when it gets published. But Metal Gear Solid 5 is probably the best playing video game that came out the entire year, which is tough because there are a lot of really great playing video games that came out in 2015.
So when you say that, you mean actual gameplay? Like
gameplay, but even plays, even past how it plays, like
mechanic-wise?
The execution of the systems in the game go beyond like normal, like layered metagame, right? The closest comparison, which is a very odd one, is like XCOM Enemy Unknown, which like had a phenomenal metagame that like worked super well with what that game was. But this is like, oh, you're building your base, and like as your base gets bigger, you get more soldiers for your base, and then you can open up new research and you can research new guns, but you can also like research new like things to dynamically drop into the world, like get tanks and like drop them on people, or like get airstrikes, and your new guns also come with new equipment. Your new equipment lets you do something. Like if you like you're looking at a base, right? Like maybe like the example I used in my review was like it's a base like embedded in like a really tall wall. And like you see, like it layers up and it kind of goes deeper into the mountain. And you're like, well, how do I want to approach this? I could wait until nighttime dynamically, and I could actually like watch the guard patrols and see if I could slip past them all. Or I could just airstrike the place and put them all to sleep with like sleeping gas strikes. Or I could shoot my way through. And it's like you get an idea in your head of what you want to do, and then you can execute on it. Like it is one of the things where it's like, I want to do this and then I did it, as opposed to I want to do this and I tried it and I kind of worked. It is like the only time in a video game where I've ever felt like I could achieve the way I wanted to do something exactly how I did it. And the gameplay and the controls and everything are so polished and good in a way that like that the relationship between what you want to do and doing it is seamless. Like there's no hesitation, there's no second tries, it just works. And like that's the greatest compliment I can give to a game like this, that is like approach anything you want to do except for real this time. And it like delivering that experience was it was something else. So
you know, Agent Hardwire in the chat, she says, I hate the Metal Gear series a lot, but I did think MGS5 played well. So there's an endorsement on the play style. Someone who wants to give the Atari ET treatment to the entire series agrees it plays well.
Yeah, I mean, the Metal Gear games are not known for playing well. And so this being as good as it is a shock to everyone, including people like me who like Metal Gear. So, yeah.
Okay. Number three. Sam!
Number three.
It was Arkham Knight. Plain and simple. Which was, I mean, yep. I think if there was one criticism about it, it was it's too much like the other games.
I don't think that's a criticism. The other games
were good.
Were great.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, Mike thinks the Batmobile was the problem.
The Batmobile, I mean, yeah, we talked about this. The Batmobile was the problem. Once you like change control schemes, you kind of got away. You can kind of get away from it. There was the problem of it you being forced to use it. But I mean, I guess I'll just say it. Like I looked at it and I was like, I had a lot of enjoyment playing the game. The Batmobile missions felt fun to me. the ones where it was like the Batmobile races. I liked the way the story rolled out a lot better, and including the side quests. I don't ever think I got as we lose Alex.
That was almost bad.
I don't think I ever got as much out of the side quests as I did out of this iteration of the game. And
yeah, I agree with that.
It was just fun to play. You know, I think were there issues? Probably. The fact that like there were 250 Riddler things in the game was ridiculous, and
249 actually.
Sorry, 49 is just fucking ridiculous. But I mean it. I think it didn't necessarily exceed expectations, but it definitely like met them head on.
Yeah,
with one punch. No, I'm just kidding.
One punch, Batman.
I honestly like my favorite part of Arkham Knight. I got the season pass for it.
Oh.
And I loved every bite-sized story that came out with it. Oh. It was very similar. Like, what was the last one? Arkham City. had, you know, DLC to it, but it was really silly. It was more challenge maps, different characters you could do the challenge maps with.
The Harley Quinn stuff was really good.
And then at the end, they came out with the Harley Quinn stuff, which was a bite-sized story. and that is what every bit of DLC has been for Arkham Knight, are these little self-contained bite-sized stories. And I think they're great. I really enjoyed the Batgirl one.
Yes, absolutely.
That one was a lot of fun to play through. And
Batgirl's awesome.
I thought they did the story really well. There were quite a few moments in the Arkham Knight story where I was like, oh, right. You guys can't see my face.
Yeah. I think I imitated the face accurately.
You did.
Yeah. Yep. That's exactly the face I made, Alex. Thank you.
I knew it. That's the face I was making when I was crying on the airplane.
Yeah. So no, I think that's a good number three. My number three, and part of why this is number three for me is because I have not sat down and played as much of it as I would have liked. And that's Fallout 4.
Woo!
I love the Fallout series. I think there are very few people who were more excited than me about Fallout 4 coming out, because I have played Fallout since Fallout was shitty.
Hey Ben, did you get the Pip-Boy edition?
No, because I didn't want to spend that much money.
So I'm pretty sure there's a ton of people who wanted it more than you.
I also wanted a digital version of it, and the Pip-Boy edition came with a physical copy and not a digital version, which is bullshit. Those things should come out with digital codes, not physical discs.
Whoa. I feel like we
shut it down. Some real fans bought both.
Sorry.
I got you. Real fans.
Sorry. And in all honesty, another reason why Fallout 4 is my number three is because I didn't want to hear Citizen bitch at me for putting Battlefront as number three. So...
That game seems all right.
And you would have just lost that one. No, there were enough good games this year that Battlefront does not belong on a list right here.
Okay, whoa, hey.
But, you know, I'm sure we're going to be talking more and more about Fallout. So, Alex, let's talk about number two.
The Witcher. Witcher. That game's really good.
Yep.
Yeah, no, I'm just kidding. No, it's really good. It is one of the best relationships in a video game, like between two characters, that I've seen since The Last of Us. Not as good as The Last of Us, but it's really good. It establishes that relationship in a lot of really good subtle ways, and then there are other really excellent characters. The Witcher has like the benefit of like the first act of it is like the world, the part that nobody ever finished, right? Like where you can go here and then go here and then go here. And it's like huge, huge open world. You're exploring everything. And then like And it's sad that, you know, a lot of people kind of got caught up in that, which I did too. But like after you get through that first act, it also has like this really cool kind of focused linear portion of it where you're like kind of going from story beat to story beat, and a lot's happening and a lot's changing and the world is changing. So it does tote the line of like the best of both worlds of being like a really cool open world experience and then a really cool driven like story experience that's pretty linear until you finish it and it kind of like throws you back out into the world. It's really great. Like it's hard to like really put into words why it works so well. I mean, like there are a lot of issues with the gameplay and the mechanics and the leveling system, but it kind of like overcomes those issues with character and world and intrigue and side quests that actually matter and people that feel like people. So it does a lot right.
Alex, I am really interested in what you have to say, but Sam is really distracting me because I don't know what he's doing, but it looks like he's eating a paperclip.
Yep.
Is that a paperclip or like a computer chip?
Nope.
It's a nail file.
It's nope. A nail. It's a collar.
It's a collar stand.
Oh. Don't eat that, Sam. Okay, well, I guess here we are. Don't smoke it either. yeah, Witcher's really good. I highly recommend it. Even if you haven't played the other ones. It's going to be tough if you haven't played one or two, but it's still fun.
Mm. Yeah, I mean... So yes. I have access to a digital copy because it was shared, and I haven't played it. I fully believe everyone who's told me how good it is. It's to me, it's just a daunt. Like it feels like a daunting time.
It is really daunting. Like don't. I ain't going front. It is a commitment if you want to like see.
And I'm also not going to lie. I still haven't finished the game, but I do play that game a lot.
It's really good. Have you gotten through Act 1, Ben?
Yeah.
Okay. That like I just hope people have gotten past Skellige and they've like actually seen where that game gets like super focused.
I spent a lot of time in Skellige.
Skellige's awesome. Skellige's like a whole different game.
When I was going through Skellige, I'm like, this is the whole world? It's not that big. What are people talking about? And then I get to the next part, I'm like, oh.
Oh. Yeah. It's pretty good. Highly recommended.
Sam, number two.
My number two is Fallout 4.
Fallout 4.
I haven't played really any of the other Fallout series to an appreciable amount. Obviously, there was a lot of hype train around 4. I played the little mini game, whatever it was called.
Dude, Fallout Shelter?
Fallout Shelter. It's an awesome game, but I had it literally crash so many times, like crash from an unrecoverable state so many times that I was just like, fuck it, I can't start that from like scratch again.
Never once happened to me.
Yeah, I wish that were the case. I'd probably still be playing it. But nah, it was fun though. I mean, the only thing I'm going to say is like, I haven't played through that much. So far, it seems pretty enjoyable. The gameplay is kind of there. Like it feeds this like collecting side of me.
Sam's number two. The gameplay is kind of there.
Well, I mean, like it's one of those things where, like, it was hard for me to approach it and think like, all right, so what am I going to really enjoy about this? Like, you know, it's not a pure first-person shooter, but it's also not, you know. Like, the VAT system's there, but you kind of can't just rely on it. And so it's a good,
which
like,
is a huge thing. Change from the old Fallout. Oh, because
used to, like,
the be able to shooting just... in like, Fallout 3 was god-awful. And if you didn't use the VAT system, you were going to die.
Okay. Yeah.
I mean, essentially, VATS is there because they knew the shooting was terrible.
Oh. Well, this is an interesting mix, then.
Yeah, I think they did a fantastic job.
Yeah, yeah.
Shooting.
I will say my biggest shout out to the game is for a great use of a companion app. I think the companion app's great.
It's instantaneous.
Yeah.
Like I use Xbox Glass and I use the PlayStation one a lot, but it's like it takes 30 seconds for me to finally sync it up. Whereas I turn on the app, I turn on the game, and it's there. And it's like,
I use it as a fucking map. Like I can literally like turn my controller and see exactly where I'm pointing to on the world map.
Yeah.
That's ridiculous. It's incredible. Why is there not a PC version of it?
What's really funny, I was listening to a podcast about someone was talking about the specific app, and he was trying to use it for his game, but his friend lives in the same place, and the app auto-synced to his friend's game, and he was just like, oh, and he recorded the whole thing where it's like he would wait for his friend to get in this giant battle and then switch to the fat man.
It'd be great if you like switch from a melee weapon to the fat man too.
Yeah. He talks about how he had to leave the room to continue doing this stuff, and his friend just didn't get it. Not get that that's what was happening. And it's like he would be running around and use stim packs nonstop.
That's pretty. He's like, why do I keep doing this? I definitely saw a lot of like joke posts about like, hey, if your boyfriend's playing too much Fallout, just sync your app to it and then ruin his whole life.
So. All right, Ben, you're number two.
My number two is a game that I play a lot of and I bought twice.
God, Jesus.
Technically, you bought it three. No, I'm just kidding.
And I don't know why Alex hates me so much for this game, but...
It wasn't the game. It was taking the picture on the sparrow. It was the line that you crossed.
What? Oh. At PSX? Yes. I had to get my picture on the sparrow.
God damn it.
Destiny the Taken King. And yes, I am marking that as a new game for 2015. Just because it re-released, it has more content than the original game had, and is just absolutely phenomenal.
No, it's
Destiny,
great.
Destiny the Taken King.
I mean, I don't know why I didn't make mine, but maybe because I wanted to be different, and that would be the only reason. It was really good. I think it exceeded pretty much everyone's expectations. Because I think
we've woken the hive.
Yeah. I think the only like criticism I would have is I would really love it if they like somehow brought in some of the old stuff to make it more interesting. And I'm talking about something as simple as Prison of Elders, where like we didn't have it long enough.
I honestly thought that with Taken King, they would add a 290 light level Atheon, a 290 light level Crota, and a 290 light level Prison of Elders. Like I thought that is something that they would have done, and I was kind of disappointed that they didn't. But I have a blast every time I do the Oryx raid, and
it's fun.
Like Taken King has really brought how much I Sherpa things to a new level. Like every time the Black Spindle quest comes up, I help at least one group get their Black Spindle.
God,
and
I hate that
Black never,
Spindle
never
quest.
Fucking get the Vienna Singer. I've only done the Black Spindle quest about 12 times.
Only done it twice.
Damn ship.
I did it once and I got it, so...
Yeah, you know what? So has everyone I've Sherpa'd.
But if it makes you feel any better, Ben, I only ever use the original ship that they give you just to piss literally everyone off.
Nice. So the ship I always use is Chasing Infinity, which practically nobody has. Because it was given out during the Queen's Bounty stuff.
Yes, you bragged about it to me when we were at PSX.
Oh, because nobody has it.
Suck it, Black Spindle quest thingy.
Yeah. So, how much sparrow racing did he do? Don't lie to me.
I actually have not done that much sparrow racing.
I haven't done it at all.
No,
I haven't either. It goes great racing, though, doesn't it?
And I'm actually kind of upset because I could have finished my chaperone quest line with it. I could still, but that's just a lot of sparrow racing to do in the next couple hours.
Yeah.
I literally just don't care anymore.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, like, so are you done with Destiny, Sam?
I can be convinced to go back because I still haven't beaten
Sam is art. Done with video games. I haven't seen him online in like ages.
Yeah, I mean, I'll get back online. I haven't gotten, well, first of all, I've been watching a lot of TV. But no, I still want to do an Oryx hard raid like full through because I have not done that yet.
Same here.
I've not played with either of you, and I've gotten into Destiny this year, so.
Well,
yeah. What's the problem, Ben? Why haven't we played with Alex?
I haven't played with Ben.
Alex is on all the time, but he always looks like he's playing stuff with other people, and
sure.
Because he's so popular. And
well, we should set a date night and like do a raid or something.
Yeah,
we should.
I'd be totally down. I think my biggest problem now is that like the variability of people and what they're playing online is so high now that I like. That's my problem with Destiny. I play Destiny with people. Mm-hmm. And so, like, the second Fallout 4 came out, no one was, like, consistently on Destiny unless they didn't play Fallout 4. Yeah. And so, like, it's really hard for me to be like, oh, let's get this raid group together. Like, let's do all this other stuff. So I am fully on for playing more Destiny, especially for all of us who haven't gotten some of the things that we want to get. Let's do it.
Yeah, I will say just real quick, Destiny is on my full top 10 list. I really like it. It's really good. I didn't play any Destiny until this year. And I'm really happy with the experience I've had, which has been, as a mostly solo gamer, it's been playing that with people. And it's kind of awesome.
Yeah, that's great.
Let's just go play Destiny for the rest of forever right now.
Holding let's hands.
Cancel skipping. The rest of the show.
Well, when Destiny 2 comes out in September, we can do that. So.
Yeah. All right. Number one, Alex.
My number one is
Passion Passion.
My number one is a video game called Life is Strange. Have either of you heard of this before?
Yes.
I brought it up.
I've heard of it once you brought it up.
I've played the first episode, which was free on PlayStation, which I had a blast playing. I don't know why I haven't just buckled down and gotten the season pass or whatever they call it. But no, it looks fun. It's fun. I enjoy it.
It's really kind of amazing. Like, I really like it. It's connected with me again. It's one of those things that,
we are hitting the 2 hour mark. Just so you know, this is the longest episode of Nerdy Night Radio.
That's what I do. No, seriously, every podcast I've been on, like been a guest on, it's always been their longest episode ever. So I'm sorry.
We had other problems.
True. There was technical difficulties, but I love it. Like, it is at its core, it's like about this really beautiful relationship between these two people, and I think. The reason it works is it is probably the most believable friendship slash more between anybody. Like I have a couple of like best friends that I feel like I have like that kind of connection with. And the way they like illustrate it and set it up in this is absolutely there. And they're just subtle things that they do across the five episodes that really drive that home. Like anything I could say probably wouldn't do the game justice. It's phenomenal. It's poignant. It covers issues like assault and suicide and depression head on. It talks about things that are serious, but it also lets you have a good time. And it reminds you about like what's really important and how important the time you spend with people is. And it's all kind of like wrapped around in this cool sci-fi story of a girl who gets superpowers. It's unlike anything I've ever experienced before. It is the best use of like an episodic series I've ever seen, like as far as like setting stuff up, having really complete self-contained episodes with excellent cliffhangers that lead well into one another, and actually delivering a better episode each time they release. So it's really cool. It's a game I think everybody should at least give a shot. So I'm very, very high recommendation. Like if this could be like something like Witcher or Metal Gear, like it's got to mean a lot to me. So it's something out there. So
yeah, I think it's a great game. Or, you know, what I've played of it is
I think great. It's a great first episode.
It's a great first episode.
It gets, like, even better, so.
Sam is sitting in chat bullying people right now, and I find it very, very bothersome.
I just turned on my PS4. Screw you guys!
Sam, what is your number one?
My number one is Bloodborne!
Boo!
Now that's a video game.
I'll say this, like one, you know, this was another one of those situations where I had a friend who was really like irrationally passionate about the series. and so I was kind of like, I don't know. Like, but I got it and I started playing it and I was very much like, well, fuck this game. This game sucks. and then I read like, like five things you should know about
Sam, how to play this game. I have to interrupt you. Look at what Agent Hardwire just said.
It's okay.
Yeah, Bloodborne ? Not adding you now.
It's okay. I got Citizen. He's got one back. No. Like, so I was super frustrated, and then I read like a quick fact on like, here's how you play the game for those who've never played the game before or anything similar. Because there's no tutorial. And then all of a sudden I kind of liked it. And then it was one of those things where I think in games like that, especially with the level of frustration that comes with a game like that, I definitely look for like, hey, I'm going to just cheat. I'm going to figure out a way to like bypass things. I'll just do all this other stuff. And like, for better or worse, I just didn't feel like you could even do that with the game, and I never did. Like, I didn't do the pebble trick, and that didn't even last that long. And I played through almost all of the game. I would have beaten it, but there were, like, certain things you were supposed to do ahead of time to get certain things, and whenever something like that happens, like, I tend to, like, kind of fall off the wagon, and then a new game will come out, and I'll be like, oh, well, I'll play this new game. Which I think at the time was House of Wolves. But no, I thought it was really great, and it did really well. I think it sold incredibly well, which I think was pretty surprising for that type of game. So I was happy.
Yeah, especially for a PS4 exclusive as well. As a proud owner of the Bloodborne Platinum, I really like that game.
No way. Really?
Yep.
Nice.
I'm impressed. Nice.
Yeah, I mean, I've beaten Demon's Souls, Dark Souls, Dark Souls 2. I love that series, I guess, if you want to call it that. So, yeah,
So what you're saying is Bloodborne was easy for you.
Bloodborne is actually, it's the second easiest in the series, I think. But, like, that's just because they changed it. They retooled the way that the movement in that game works. Like, going from Bloodborne to, like, something like Dark Souls 2, Sam, you'd probably, like, fucking kill somebody. So.
Great.
Yeah, it's so I guess coming off of Dark Souls 2 is a little bit easier for me. So Ben,
my number one is The Witcher 3.
Really?
Which I really want to say, I hope that James does not listen to this episode, because him and I have a bet that The Witcher 3 would not be Game of the Year this year. And I really
bet against it, liked it.
I did bet against it.
Well, Jeff Keighley disagrees.
I know that Jeff Keighley disagrees, but who gives a shit about what Jeff Keighley thinks?
Whoa. Whoa.
No, but like, everything you were saying about the game, Alex, I agree with wholeheartedly. Every single relationship in that game has meaning. And I love that. And what I love even more is that every action you take, you see, maybe not right away, but eventually you see how, like, very minor decisions affect the rest of the world that you are in. And there's just so much that you can do in that game. So much. I love the game. And I think CD Projekt Red did a fantastic job with everything that they did for it. Like, all of that free content that they put out for it, and everything that they did to to fix some of the story stuff that people were having issues with, like, you know, having a relationship with Triss instead of Yennefer. I think developers can learn a lot from CD Projekt Red just in how they handled everything with the game. And I think Mike just said it in my ear, but I have to agree with him. I think they showed up Bethesda a bit. And by a bit, I mean a lot.
I actually agree. Yeah.
I mean, it made Fallout look bad, in all honesty. Like, Fallout came out and it's still in that same crappy engine. And it's like, The Witcher 3 does everything that Fallout does, probably a little bit more, and it still looks absolutely stunning. Like, absolutely stunning. And it's fantastic. And it's a wonderful, wonderful game. And, yeah, just everything about it. There were times where I was playing the game where I was legitimately getting scared. They did that game very well. And I agree with Citizen. I am really excited to see what Cyberpunk 2077 is. And he wants us to make sure we watch Developer Diaries coming out this year. And I guess we could maybe talk about them. Maybe. On the shows. So Witcher 3 is my number one.
That's one hell of a video game.
Yeah.
Well, okay.
So here we go. Fallout 4 and Witcher 3, I think, are going to have to be in the top three for the overall list. How do we want to go about doing this?
I don't know.
Hey, I like Bloodborne.
I think there could be a case made for Bloodborne or Destiny as the last one.
I think I am okay with Bloodborne making the list because I know that it was I know it was a great game, and I know that a lot more went into it than Destiny as a whole. So I would be willing to say that the Nerdy Knights 3. Would be Witcher, Bloodborne, Fallout. That order.
What about Witcher, Bloodborne, Fallout?
Are we talking about what? Witcher, Bloodborne, and then Fallout? Is that what we're doing here?
Like, I feel like just the rankings of Fallout versus, like, the rankings of, Witcher.
I'm okay with this. I'm legitimately okay with it. I think there's more people who have played Fallout, but I feel like Bloodborne might have just done a better job in a completely different way.
In a different genre as well.
In a different genre, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, Sam, by that argument, Call of Duty should be game of the year almost every year.
No, exactly. Exactly. Exactly.
It's the best shoot game with the shoots.
And I swear to God, if Call of Duty is ever game of the year, I'm just going to... That's the last year in video games.
Call of Duty 4 was a legitimate contender for game of the year.
Call of Duty 4 was actually good. But then every game after that was Call of Duty 4.
Sure.
Call of Duty 4, Madden 16.
It's just like, as long as you're not a World at War defender, I don't really care.
All right, guys. That has been 2 hours of the Nerdy Night radio show. And it's 2 hours that has just been so long because you can't see my beautiful face, and I apologize for that.
You're welcome.
I'm hungry. I want the foods.
So I want to say thank you guys so much for joining us. This was a lot of fun. If you have any ideas for other Top 2015 topics, please let us know. Remember, you can find us all over the internet. Alex1ill can be found on Twitter at ALFighter27. He can be found pretty much everywhere as ALFighter27. Be sure to check out his show, Irrational Passions, and their website, irrationalpassions.com.
Yes, correct.
That's a thing. That's
you nailed
a real
it.
Thing. So make sure to check out his stuff. Give him some love. Watch out, because eventually I'll be doing that little top 10 thing that he was talking about with him. And you can find Sam pretty much everywhere on the internet as DJ Fluffkins. No, really. Everywhere.
Everywhere.
One punch!
One punch!
That is going to be the name of this episode. Nerdy Nights Radio, episode 21. One punch!
Really not Mile Cry Club? I was really shooting for that one.
That was pretty good.
That was pretty good.
You know what? That's going to be the name of our
Lonely Hearts
February 14th episode.
Yeah, yeah. I like it.
And of course, you can follow me on Twitter. I am at BRiddiculous. That's BRIDDICKULOUS. You can follow everything Nerdy Knights related on Twitter at Nerdy_Knights. And of course, look at everything on our website, www.nkrn.org. Remember, Nerdy Knights Radio is live on Twitch every Monday evening at 7:30 Pacific time, and you can be a part of the show by participating in chat like Citizen PM and Agent Hardwire did, which was awesome. Thank you guys so much for joining us. And you can find the show in split videos on YouTube after it has been, you know, finished at www.youtube.com/channel/NKR Productions. Be sure to like and subscribe any of the videos that you like. And by subscribing, you get to see all of our awesome, awesome things. We have some really cool announcements coming with the new year, so stay tuned for that.
They're so special. Even I don't know about them.
Yep, that's very true, Sam. I don't tell Sam about anything.
I didn't know about this, that we were recording this until like 4 hours ago, so.
So when we started the show. And of course, you can also find the full audio version of this podcast on iTunes, which you should leave a nice little review for us so other nerds like you can come to the realm of the Nerdy Night. Guys, it has been a Nerdy Night. I officially dubbed the Nerdy Knights of the Round. Go out and defend the realm of the Nerdy Night. And remember, until next week, it's dangerous to go alone.